feel totally ecstatic about a phenomenon like Guitar Hero because it gets people listening to music. Coming here to Neversoft, it really reminds me of the old days with the label. There's a lot of energy in the building. People are really excited. They love the images of rock and roll. They love the music. They're looking for songs that will challenge the people playing the game. Guitar Hero right now represents music that people actually listen to. I mean, I'm just totally overjoyed that they want our music in the game, that they ask me to be a part of the game.
Welcome to episode 20 of the Hipsters United podcast. My name is Chris, and joining me this week after a brief hiatus are Jason.
Hey.
And Andrew.
Hey.
Due to our weeks off, this week we'll talk about the news that's taken place over the past 3 weeks, but first we have breaking news that won't be breaking by the time the podcast gets released. But the Fillmore DVD, If It All Goes Wrong, recently showed up on Amazon.com as having a November 11th release date. So we may be getting our first Pumpkins release since Super Christ in about 2 months, a little less than 2 months from now. But according to that Amazon sales page, most of the information was kind of what we already knew. The DVD is going to be 2 discs, which we'd already heard was going to be multiple discs. And one interesting factoid from it, though, is that the DVD will clock in at a robust 271 minutes. So,
wow. You guys buy that? 4.5 hours? That seems extreme.
That does seem pretty extreme. I guess how long... The shows were pretty long, but nothing close to that. How long were those shows? About, what, 2.5, 3 hours?
Right. I'm thinking it might be maybe a full performance, which might be 2.5, 2:45.
Are you going to give us 100 fictional dollars?
I've lost enough fictional dollars.
I will bet against the full show. But it's possible. I mean, you're right. There's room for it.
Yeah.
There's room for it, but if it is a documentary, like they keep saying, I think you're right. It doesn't really seem to fit with the pattern of having it be a documentary. But I mean, that's pretty damn long for someone talking about the performances.
No, I mean, if it's really 4.5 hours long, there's going to be a lot of music. I mean, I don't think there's any question that they're not going to be sitting there talking for 3 hours. So it could be a lot of music, which obviously that would be very exciting. Yeah, the whole thing. Ah, nobody wants to see us play Gossamer. We announced this reunion. They think it's like Stone Temple Pilots reunion. What's wrong with these people? Just 3 hours of that, and then like 3 different versions of Gossamer, and that's the 4.5 hours. You know what, one of the things I find funny about it, if it really is that long, I remember how when they were saying that they were going to come out with the special edition of Zeitgeist with the Making of Zeitgeist documentary DVD, and at first they said it's a full-length DVD, and then it comes out and it was like half hour.
Right.
And this one there's been a lot of advanced discussion of it, and nobody has really said anything about how long it was going to be. And then the first thing you see that says the length says 271 minutes, 4.5 hours. So it's like, okay, a full-length DVD was 30 minutes, and a DVD that no one has talked about how long it is 4.5 hours long. You know, so maybe. We'll see. I'm not sure. That, you know, what would be totally possible is that we're making a big deal out of something that's a typo or a mistake in the Amazon listing, but that's the thing that jumps out at me for sure.
And what was the price on that? The list was around $22.
List price $21.98, but your price on Amazon $14.99. You save $6.99 or 32%.
That's a pretty good deal for 271 minutes. Too bad we don't have some sort of Amazon affiliation on Hipsters United. This would be a great time to plug that if we did.
It probably wouldn't be hard to create one, but you know, those things always annoy me on other people's sites, to be honest.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
But on to the rest of the news. In a blog posting on SmashingPumpkins.com back on August 27th, Billy thanked fans for coming to the August tour dates and, in his own words, made a small declaration that, in his mind, Pumpkins music, previously categorized as everything from new wave, grunge, alternative, and just plain old rock, is actually of its own genre, which he calls American Gothic. And he goes on to explain that, quote, "It embodies both the English ideal of Gothic music and the decay of Americana," unquote. So, Andrew, do you think this is an accurate classification for the totality of the band's catalog?
I think it's an interesting it's interesting that Billy tries to come up with one label that describes their entire body of work. They've always simply been filed under alternative rock, which was a valid musical category about 1996. So, what a lot of people think of gothic music is not what does not match what the Smash Drums do. But if you look at their style, their visual style, I guess is very gothic. With all the costuming that Billy likes to do nowadays, and videos like the Stand Inside Your Love video, which was, I think we can say that was gothic, but
Baroque. I have no idea what that means.
I think, and it's definitely American music. I think it's, you can definitely call it American music. So I think it's as valid title as any, and it was kind of neat to see Billy try to put a label out there for Smashing Pumpkins music.
Yeah, I thought that was kind of interesting, since usually he tries to avoid, classifying his music into any different labels. But here he assigns one label to the whole catalog, which is amazingly varied. But I actually did some research on this, because when I thought about gothic music, I always thought of the mid to late 90s teenagers wearing trench coats and black nail polish and listening to Marilyn Manson. But what Billy refers to as the English ideal of gothic music, according to Wikipedia, my source of all knowledge and information, it actually began in the late 1970s with bands like Joy Division, Susie and the Banshees, and The Cure. And the comparison to The Cure, I thought, was especially revealing, since they've also been defined in the past as both new wave and alternative, and they've been named as a chief influence of the Pumpkins, especially the pre-Gish Pumpkins. If you go back and listen to that era, it sounds very Cure-y. But once the Pumpkins kind of became big in their own right and developed their own signature sound, though, I think their music became less gothic, so to speak, and more kind of like their own brand of straightforward rock. So perhaps this is the American part that Billy's talking about? I don't know, I'd consider myself not at all a music historian. What do you guys think?
Yeah, I'm not a historian either. The label that has been applied to the Pumpkins' music far more than any other over the course of the band, as far as I'm concerned, is alternative rock. And it's a label that the band has embraced in the past. I remember Billy at once, I'm paraphrasing, but I know once he said something like, "We're very proud to be called an alternative band." The band's MySpace page, I don't know if it's still this way, but when they relaunched the MySpace page, or launched it on the occasion of the reformation of the band, there was one genre that they picked. You're allowed to pick three. They picked one, alternative, and that was, it. They didn't try to go alternative goth rock, it was just alternative. And so I would never be one to accuse Billy of being consistent over time, and I'm not even going to say that being consistent over time is some sort of huge virtue, but I think this is a change, to kind of have this, now I don't really like the label alternative. I mean, that's a change, for sure. Whether American Gothic is fitting, I don't really know. I'm not an expert on where names come from, but what little I do know about it, groups in society tend to be named by their detractors. Billy's appearing in some shoegazing documentary, and the reason I mention this is I remember reading the article about the documentary. It said that the name Shoegazers was a derogatory name provided by someone else,
right?
From outside the scene, and that is, you hear that all the time. Where did your why do they call you so-and-so? And it's like, well, that's just what the people who didn't like us started calling us, so this idea that the Pumpkins are going to name their own genre of music, I think, is almost certainly just kind of, I don't know. What was the phrase Billy used to describe how not very seriously of a claim he thought it was, Chris? You read it earlier. That he was making a small
declaration.
Yeah. To me, it's kind of like, you know, if I was doing this, I'd call us American Gothic. You know, as opposed to, our genre is American Gothic, dang it! You know, I don't think that's what he's doing, you know. He's more like, well, if I'm going to name it, if I were in the position to name it, I would name it this. And, you know, they came up with that little header on the website, what is it, Purveyors of Fine American Gothic Music Since 1987. You know, that's kind of amusing, but...
Yeah. I thought the funniest part was, I think you pointed out, Jason, that now all of a sudden Billy seems to be dating the band back to 1987, yet they're having their 20th anniversary tour this fall.
Yeah. I did point that out, and, you know, again, how important is that either, but... And you can certainly argue, I mean, I'm sure the roots of the band do go to 87, you know? They probably go to When Billy Meets James Iha, you know, that's probably the start of the band.
Yeah.
And I don't know when that was, but it probably was 87.
I guess it's the 20th anniversary of the Smashing Pumpkins playing live.
Oh, yeah, no, definitely. I mean, as a public entity, it's 1988, for sure.
Well, a couple of weeks ago, we also got some more information about GLOW and its connection to the next iteration in the Guitar Hero franchise, which is called Guitar Hero World Tour. Activision, the publisher of Guitar Hero, confirmed via press release that GLOW would be released as an optional downloadable Guitar Hero track, along with The Everlasting Gaze and 1979, although they did not give a release date. And Activision also hinted that GLOW would be available only in this downloadable Guitar Hero form at first, before getting released later in whatever form the Pumpkins end up releasing it. So, my first question, I guess, is I was on vacation when all this news broke out, so I wasn't closely following the kind of the pulse of the Pumpkins fan community, but what was the reaction of the fan community? Like, was there any outrage that we weren't going to get a chance to download and buy this and people would have to go get Guitar Hero?
The fan community? I didn't see any outrage on hipstersunited.com, whether there was outrage in... more dark corners of the fan, the online expressive fan community. I don't know. I'm sure some people are like, "What?" But I mean, I think most people took it in stride. They know they're going to get the song. It's going to be probably within a month of when they would have gotten it anyway. And all these people are going to get the music for free anyway. So I don't know what they have to complain about. I mean, the sorts of people who would complain about it online are probably the sorts of people who are in touch enough with the way the internet works to find the song for free, right? If you're on a message board complaining about it, somebody on that message board is going to post, "Hey guys, download the new song here," you know, so if they're complaining, I wouldn't take it too seriously. You know who did complain? Pitchforkmedia.com. I know you're all shocked.
What a shock.
Let me read this. I did not blog about this on Hipsters United. Believe it or not, I have restraint. I know that sometimes the horse is dead and you don't need to beat it anymore. But they did an article about the new Guitar Hero, and here's their relevant paragraph. "But what about that new Smashing Pumpkins song, GLOW, they're debuting through the game? You've gotta pay extra for it. The only Pumpkin song that's preloaded is Today. GLOW will be available in a 3-song expansion pack that also gets you 1979 and The Everlasting Gaze. Words is cheap, exclusive content less so. Billy Corgan appears as a character in the game, as do Ted Nugent and Zach Wilde." So Pitchfork, in 3 sentences, complains that you have to pay for the song, makes fun of Billy's old blog post about words is cheap, and equates him with Ted Nugent and Zach Wilde in terms of being a serious musician. Like, you know, if ever the Pitchfork agenda to marginalize and you know, discredit and dismiss the Pumpkins as an artistic entity, like, if you needed more evidence, which no one should at this point, but that could do it for you right there, I think.
Yeah, I think that... I don't know, I follow gaming and Pumpkins news both pretty closely, but I'd imagine the band has some sort of contract with Activision that says how long the song is a Guitar Hero exclusive. I mean, Activision is using that as kind of a promotional tool, so they must have something in writing so that, you know, Billy doesn't go behind their back and release it on iTunes tomorrow. But once that time frame expires, I think it would be showing up on all of our favorite music downloadable services at that point. And if I didn't already lost all my fictional money to you, Jason, betting on the August tour. I'd guess a month after hitting Guitar Hero, it will be on iTunes.
Yeah, don't bet against me, Chris.
Yeah, sounds about right.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. There will be some sort of other release, but, you know. I don't know if we talked about this on the podcast before, but I mean, I really think they went this route to get the press from people talking about, whoa, some band's putting out brand new music through Guitar Hero. I mean, I think they knew that would be newsworthy. And in this day and age, how else to get your band's name out there in front of people? It goes right back to what, you know, Billy was unfairly criticized for what he said about Radiohead. I think it's unfair. You know, he wasn't criticizing Radiohead. He was criticizing the current era of how bands are getting attention these days. And he the quote about Radiohead and In Rainbows was, "Radiohead putting out a great album isn't the story." I'm slightly paraphrasing, but only slightly. "Radiohead putting out a great album isn't the story. Radiohead putting out a free album, that's the story." You know, so it's like Billy was saying, you can't get attention these days for just putting out good music. It's not enough. You need the extra story. You need to be Britney Spears or Amy Winehouse freaking out. You need to be Radiohead giving away a free album. Otherwise, nobody pays any attention to you, right? So I think from that standpoint, in this market, if Billy's analysis of the marketplace is right, this is a wise move because you get people talking about the song. And you wouldn't be able to get people talking about the song just on the basis of it being a great song. You know, you need to go kiss a girl, basically, if you want people to notice you, you know. So.
Yeah.
Did you guys like that? That was real subtle. Anyway. You also have to be a girl and kiss a girl.
Right.
Right.
That wouldn't be newsworthy.
Well, finally, for our in-depth discussion this week, I wanted to take a look at some comments that Billy made last week about straddling the line between the mainstream and the hardcore fans, which we've talked about previously. But in an interview with Billy, or an interview will be featured in EQ Magazine's October issue, and to promote the issue, they've posted some excerpts that didn't make the print edition. And the segment I'm referring to is a little bit long, but I'm going to go ahead and read the whole thing. So, quote, "There are a tremendous amount of opportunities for a free artist, meaning free from a label structure, to do lots of interesting things. I think the danger is when you start playing to the front row of your audience, the audience that's going to be there no matter what you do. I think it's going to take a level of sophistication to continue to be progressive, dangerous, experimental, forward-thinking, and at the same time not lose everybody in the haze of non-directed creativity. You've got to get out of the utopian idea of, now that I'm free, I can just do whatever I want to do. And I think it splits your mind. I think the middle doesn't exist anymore. You can be artistic, you can be mainstream, or you can be both, but you can't exist in the middle. I think there were times that did work for us, but I don't think it works for us anymore. We're going to have to consistently prove to people that there's a reason why we're a unique band. We still have to be able to show up and write a great song." Unquote. So Jason, do you really think it's impossible to exist in the middle, appealing to both the artistic and the mainstream? I mean, under the album format, it's possible to have an album containing both songs that appeal to the mainstream audience, like Disarm, for instance, as well as songs that are more artistic or have more depth, like something like Soma. So will this be more difficult, you think, for Billy in an era where the song instead of the album is king, or at least that's what Billy has claimed in the past?
Chris, I've got to turn it back on you for a second before I try to answer.
Okay.
Billy says you can be artistic, you can be mainstream, or you can be both, but you can't exist in the middle. So I find this an odd quote. He's saying you can be both, but you can't be in the middle. So I'm wondering, do you have an interpretation what he's trying to say? I don't care if you agree with it or not, do you have an interpretation of what he's trying to say with it?
I mean, I'm guessing he's saying you can't be kind of straddle the line at the same time. Like, you can, like, kind of like how I was saying with the album. So you can be both in that you have your mainstream songs and you have your artistic songs, and they're two separate entities, but they're both in the same album. They're both kind of in the same format associated with the band. But you can't be in the middle doing two things at once. That's my interpretation of it, at least. I agree, it's kind of, I don't know, what he's saying is kind of interesting.
I find this so hard to understand what this is saying, you know? Does he mean mainstream in the sense of the type of audience you're trying to appeal to? Does he mean it in the sense of writing music that is more similar to what's already been done, and artistic is pushing some sort of boundary, or is artistic appealing to, you know, a smaller community of people who just aren't interested in pop music, for instance, you know? Are those the same thing? I don't really know, but take a song like Mayonaise off Siamese Dream, right? I blogged fairly recently. Mayonaise seems to be a song that diehard fans and casual fans of the band agree on. Even though it wasn't a single, Mayonaise really resonated with people when they heard Siamese Dream, you know? If Mayonaise is the middle, then the idea that... And maybe that makes sense because he's saying, I think the middle doesn't exist anymore, you know? Implying that it once did, you know? Was Mayonaise the middle, and now Mayonaise is impossible? I don't know if that... There might be something to that. I can't... It's hard to address that. I mean... It would be a very, very sad commentary on our times that you couldn't write or get a song like Mayonaise to be appreciated today. That would be pretty sad.
And it kind of goes counter to what you hear. Like, with the climate of music today, like, everything I hear and read and, like, places talking about, kind of like Wired Magazine, places that talk about, you know, kind of the bleeding edge of technology in terms of, like, how the music industry is adapting it. Everyone keeps saying that, oh, well, now in this age, you don't have to be, like, attractive and, like, sign with a major label. Like, it's all based on merit, and you can release your own stuff, and you can do whatever you want, and, like, it's all about how good you are and how people like you. But this is almost saying the opposite, that it's harder to do things like that today.
You know, I could... The paragraph that you read, when he starts out talking about how it's dangerous to play to your hardcore fans. I was right there following along with him, you know, and I really understood what he was saying, and I even kind of agree with it, you know. And it fits perfectly with the ethos of the Pumpkins, because the Pumpkins never have played to the front row of their fan base, because the front row of their fan base in 1990 or whatever was people in Chicago, you know, and they reached beyond that, you know. And then when their fan base was a bunch of hipsters and college rock radio listening to Gish, you know, they reached beyond that and went mainstream, you know. And I think Melancholy was a reach toward a different fan base away from Siamese Dream, you know, going away from the... They were, you know, it kind of went even further away from an indie rock mindset with, you know, incorporating the whole Zero thing and the costumes and a concept album about being a teenager. You know, it kind of reached out to this kind of suburban mall rat type audience too, you know, and I'm not saying that to be negative toward that audience at all. I mean, I think that sort of, and then with Adore, I mean, obviously Adore was, again, like, pushing away from the audience that he had toward a new audience, hopefully, you know, whether it did it work, not necessarily, right? I mean,
he's even said at this point that it didn't work.
Yeah, I mean, you might have tried to reach a different audience from the one you currently have, and then you failed to reach that audience, right? But that point he was making about not playing the front row of the audience, not, quote, losing everybody in the haze of non-directed creativity, and not believing this idea that, hey, I can do whatever I want. I mean, I was completely following him, but this part of the quote that you're picking up on about, you know, you can't exist in the middle, that's where I'm not really sure what he means, so...
Well, it almost sounds like he's saying that the songs that the Pumpkins have had that have been the hit singles aren't artistic, because he has this strong contrast between being artistic and being mainstream. So, I mean, Andrew, do you think that, like, are any of the Pumpkins hit singles artistic? Like, if a song has a hook in it, is it by definition no longer a worthwhile piece of art?
That seems to be Radiohead's thesis, that a song can't have a hook in it. But
a lot of bands' thesis. That's a lot of indie rock writers' thesis.
Yeah.
Right.
You know who the one person... I'm sorry to cut you off, Andy. I'm going to go right back. But I just want to credit her. She has many fans. Jill, who is usually part of our podcast and couldn't make it this week, she's the one person I credit with, like, ripping off the blinders in front of my face and saying, Jason, it's not that the song is pop music. It's that the song is good. You like it not because it's pop music, but because it's good. And I was like, wow, she's right. So, anyway, I give Joe all the credit for that. In my personal coming around to realizing that, you know, artistic and having a hook are not at all exclusive, and in fact might actually be closer to being the same thing. But very good point, Andy. Back to you.
Yeah, I think I wouldn't think that Billy would say that a song like Today or Full of Butterfly Bullet with Butterfly Wings would is disqualified as being artistic because they became hit radio songs. I think, but I think that, you know, the fact that there was a hook there and that hook was catchy and that hook attracted a lot of attention was sort of, I think, that's definitely artistic to come. I think there's no to come up with a hook that makes people sit up and listen and kind of break away from the muddle of everything. I think you have to say that is an artistic talent in the song, that even if it becomes a cliche sort of a thing, like Rat in a Cage, the line Rat in a Cage, the whole chorus has become, I think you can't take away the artistic effort that it took to create that in the first place. But I think, you know, getting back to this divide between being artistic and being mainstream, I think maybe what Billy is getting at is that to sort of point your efforts to the mainstream, I think, causes you to perhaps make some choices that limits you artistically. Maybe does, you know, to point, say, okay, to be popular, I have to make the song sound this way. So you have to go down a certain road with a song or a idea that you got in your head. And then by doing that, you limit yourself. I think maybe, so you kind of have to go with where you think the song should go and not worry about, well, if I do it this way, you know, it's not gonna be hugely popular, but it might be a good effort that will be appreciated by people who take the time to listen to it and appreciate it for whatever the artistic quality of it is. And maybe it won't stand out on the radio and get played on the radio or become a popular song that people go search for on iTunes. But
you know what he might be saying? Like, this is just maybe coming to me as we're talking about this. Maybe he's saying sort of like, you can't have a left field hit anymore. You know, that the changes in the marketplace and the way people are consuming music have made it so you can't, like, obviously it's still possible to write a song like Mayonaise, you know? Obviously it's possible to still write a song like, I don't know, Mayonaise is my example, I'm going to stick with it, you know? So what he's saying, since it's obviously still possible to write the song, it's got to be something about how the song would be accepted, listened to by people, you know? It seems like he's saying there's no audience, there's no path to success for a song that kind of has one foot in both, you know, trying to reach out to a wide audience and is trying to be true to these artistic, you know, things. I don't know if that's true. I don't follow the charts. I don't know what the kids are listening to. I mean, I guess this would be something that I don't know anything about, but I remember reading something recently. You know, there's been this artist, God, I don't even know how to pronounce her name. Is it M-I-A? Do they say it? Is it Mia? Maya? It's just M-I-A. It's an abbreviation.
Well, like, you know, GLOW.
She's had all this buzz, right? And like, underground. And then her song suddenly became a big hit. I mean, it was like a top 10 Billboard single I saw recently. And it's a song that I know people in the underground have been talking about for a long time. So if people in the underground like it, obviously it's artistic. So I don't know. Maybe that's counter evidence for what he's saying, or maybe that's not. I mean, that's still, it's so hard for me to interpret what he's going on about. But, you know, it, I mean, it's what Andy was saying. I mean, and the idea that he says you can be both, but you can't be in the middle. I mean, it sounds like he thinks you need to write GLOW if you're trying to reach a big audience, and you need to write STELLAR if you're trying to be artistic, you know, because STELLAR doesn't have a hook. did I say that? STELLAR does not have a hook.
Yeah.
You know, so that would seem to me, I mean, Chris, does that, he's written Mayonaise, he's written these a lot, I mean, you know, I think a lot of Pumpkin songs, people would say, have managed this trick of having mainstream appeal and being artistic, but were they both? Or is that the middle? I mean, you know, it's weird.
I'd really think Mayonaise is a good example, because didn't Mayonaise get some radio play? Like, obviously it wasn't a single, but I seem to remember hearing it very occasionally in Atlanta on modern rock radio there.
I don't know if it ever charted at all.
No, so it definitely didn't chart, but it got some attention, at least.
If you go to a Pumpkin show and they play Mayonaise, everyone will go crazy.
Everyone knows it, yeah.
And there aren't very many songs like that, even in their own catalog. I mean, that weren't singles, you know? But I guarantee you, people will go crazy for Mayonaise. And I'm not just making this up. Like, I've seen it happen too many times. You know, it's the whole crowd. It's not like when they start The Aeroplane Flies High and you hear, it's not like Set the Rate of Jerry. Set the Rate of Jerry is the example, right? Because okay. If you go to a show and there's 3,000 people and they start playing Set the Rate of Jerry, 200 people will go crazy. Like, there will be a guy a couple rows over who will, like, start screaming and flipping out, you know, or whatever. Like, that's the reaction of Set the Rate of Jerry, you know, that's not what happens when Mayonaise starts, you know, it's the whole audience.
I had that happened to me when I went to the in 1998, I think it was, when they did the Christmas show in L.A., and they came out with Rotten Apples. That was like, they were like, most of the crowd was like, had no idea what the song was, but there were like a few people scattered about it, like, oh my god! That was fun. That was that moment.
Yeah, I've seen it. It's that. I hate that moment, to be honest. I'm embarrassed. I'm like, I know this song, but I'm not going to admit it.
What you were saying about GLOW versus STELLAR, I think was very true. Like, it really seemed, and that seemed to be a lot of when people were kind of first reacting to GLOW. I mean, the first reaction to it was, oh, it's so jock rock. It's so, like, mainstream. You know, modern rock radio sounding. Do you think Billy's changed his songwriting to kind of write in these two kind of schizophrenic styles? One as, like, you know, the hit single writer, and one as the, you know, serious artist? Has he always done that?
That's the question I've been asking myself the last 5 minutes, you know, since I said that. I'm like, has he really bifurcated his songwriting? And I think to some extent, yes. To some extent, no. And I think the next things he puts out are really going to tell you, you know? But I think if you look back at Zeitgeist, the answer is no. I mean, what on Zeitgeist is the artistic and what on it is the mainstream? I find it to be pretty much a blending. Is Doomsday Clock... Okay, Doomsday Clock is the mainstream. What's Seven Shades of Black? I don't know. There's a lot of songs that I think are both.
Yeah.
But has there been I don't know. That's such a weird question, because it's so hard to, like, classify your songs, right? But I mean, if you look at the Chicago songs, you look at the Future Embrace, I mean, those songs are clearly, I think, the artistic song, the hookless monsters, you know, that nobody wants to listen to, but they're artistic or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, except there are a few, I mean, there are a couple songs with hooks on Future Embrace. And Billy said something at the time he was coming out with Future Embrace. He's like, I'm not going to apologize. You know, he was talking about how, he was talking about this very thing, and he said something like, I'm not going to apologize because I can write a hook. You know? And I was like, you go, Billy. Like, you know, don't let these people cow you into not wanting to write songs with hooks. You know? But I don't know. I think you could look at some of the Residency songs and say, where's the hook? You could look at the American Gothic songs and ask that question on a couple of them, you know? Like, is Sunkissed a catchy song? Not really. Some of the others are. But Rosemarch seems to kind of be both. I don't know. It's weird. This is so...
Is it a coincidence, then, that Rosemarch is kind of I would consider it the best of the American Gothic songs.
I would too. Chris, I hate to say, maybe we're making too much out of a confused moment in the mind of Billy Corgan.
But that's what we're all about.
I think this quote may just be him, like, trying to make... I don't even know if what he said would make sense to him, frankly. I kind of hope that's the case. I think he's too old to just have some sea change. And, I mean, I think he's saying we're going to be both, you know? But does that really... I just can't imagine that the sorts of, like, songs that have hooks in that are interesting are going to disappear. And here's the thing with GL.O.W., right? I mean, I think it's unfair to GL.O.W. to just throw it in the jock rock category. And I think that's ridiculous. People tried to say this about Tarantula, too. Like, oh, it's radio ready. I think that was crazy. I think, like pretty much every Pumpkin success, the radio success of Tarantula, to me, is bizarre. Because that song is weird. I mean, that song is structurally bizarre.
Yeah.
And you know, the trick of it is that it is so structurally bizarre, and yet it kind of comes across like a radio-ready song. Because, I mean, obviously the people criticizing it as a radio-ready song are not totally stupid. I mean, they're hearing something, right? But, like, to me, I hear a tremendous song. I hear a song that is, like, really creative, really complicated, and is finding new ways to, like, somehow be immediate. You know, I think Tarantula is an amazing single. It's probably one of the very best singles that I think they've ever put out. And GL.O.W., you know, we don't have the studio version, but if you listen closely to the live track, it's very similar to Tarantula, in that the structure is weird. It is weird. But at the same time, it doesn't seem weird, necessarily. But if you pay attention, you're like, this is really bizarre. Like, if you start saying, okay, they should come back in with the chorus here, well, wait, they never really do the chorus the same way twice, and, you know, there's all these things going on. I don't know. So, if Billy thinks that the mainstream is GL.O.W. and Tarantula, I say, more please, you know. I'm not worried at all that he's going to start, like, tossing off really stupid singles. I mean, that's just, he's not capable.
Yeah.
He would be too bored.
I guess we'll just have to see what the future has in store after GL.O.W., then.
Embrace the future.
Yeah. Well, Andrew, what happened this week in Pumpkin's history?
Well, we have a fairly bit of semi-recent Pumpkin history this week. We have, September 15th of 2003, Billy appeared on the... WGN in Chicago, local radio station, and officially announced that Zwan was no more. That was a good long while after the last appearance of Zwan, and they had already kind of gone their separate ways. The last concert was in June, early June, and, you know, Paho had already sort of set out on his own already. But that was the when Billy officially said that Zwan was no more.
Publicly.
Publicly, yeah.
Publicly.
That was the first confirmation.
There's no
publicly.
Such thing as official.
That's true. They didn't file any paperwork to say
that. Nothing on file with the government.
That's true. So that was the big event this week in Pumpkin history.
Well, we all remember where we were when we heard that the Pumpkins were breaking up the first time.
I thought you were going to say Zwan.
Where were you when you heard that Zwan was officially dissolved?
No memory of that.
Neither do I.
I was probably like, oh, I thought they already said that.
Yeah, I think it's poorly kept secret if it was one.
Yeah,
pretty
right.
Much everyone knew.
Well, thanks for tuning in this week, and next week I think we're going to finally break down and discuss the Machina mystery, since it has been the subject of a number of the SP.com articles.
I would like to take this moment to announce my immediate resignation.
But,
Well, I'm kidding. I wouldn't miss this for the world. Machina mystery, I live for that. Come on, bring it on.
Hopefully we'll have Jill back next week to talk about that so we can have the full arsenal of panelists. But everyone else out there, keep the comments coming. And this week's Song of the Week is one of, I guess I would call it one of the more artistic of Pumpkin songs, one of the, Jason, I think you called the soft, loud, soft 7 or 8 minute fan favorites about longing.
Totally epic, dude.
Through the Eyes of Ruby from Madrid on May 3rd, 1996. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Midnight Podcast is not affiliated with or endorsed by the Smashing Pumpkins, Virgin Records, or Warner Brothers Reprise Records. All opinions offered by panelists or guests of the Hipsters United Podcast are their own and do not represent the opinions of the Smashing Pumpkins. All audio during the show is licensed for nonprofit use per the terms and conditions on the Live Music Archive at archive.org. Intro music is from the Machina 2 album released for free download on the internet by the Smashing Pumpkins in September of 2000.